Life, Western Region, or actually, how far do you?
Connecticut Valley District.
Connecticut Valley District. He has a wealth of information to share with us, and for that reason, we were going to videotape his talk today, and we've got Cecil B. Jamie over here doing the honors. Mr. Covey has 38 years with the Mass Division of Fisheries and Wildlife, so he is he's forgotten more about wildlife management than we could ever hope to know. So without any further ado, I'll let him begin.
Good morning. I'd like to say, if I was, when I first started with the outfit, if I was put in prison for a major crime to serve 20 years, I'd have been back on the streets 18 years ago. Did everybody get one of these? Okay. Just a quick introduction inside to let you know some of the division installations. There's a map. There's two colors here. I represent the Valley District, which is this pink one over here, based at Westboro. In here, it gives you the contact people from our different offices. We have a field headquarters at Westboro. There's an office in Boston where our major administrative offices are. And there are five wildlife districts, one game farm, and three trout hatcheries. What I wanted to do this morning was just to do a picture here. We have a film. We finally got the projector to run. It's on Mass Wildlife. It has a little bit of everything in it. I'd like to run that off for, we'll talk about maybe a management program on a particular species or whatever. If you have questions, why don't you write them down, we'll try to handle them at the end of the session. Are we ready for the film?
Jim, would you get the lights?
One of the smallest and most densely populated states of the nation. But even so, more than 60% of the land still remains forested greenbelt, rich in resources and natural wildlife. It's claimed that almost 1,000 years ago, the Viking navigator Leif Erikson explored the Massachusetts coastline. Rock-strewn North Shore to the pristine beaches at Cape Cod. Hundreds of miles of some of the richest waterfowl habitat on the continent. Also penetrated our inland marshes and rich alluvial valleys. Did they discover the unusual geology of the Holyoke mountain range, stretching east to west instead of the more conventional north to south? Did they see the Berkshires, with majestic Mount Greylock rising almost 3,500 feet above sea level. And what about the wildlife? Did these Vikings collect the unique blue lobsters from the cold depths of our coastal waters? Were there red-winged blackbirds in the marshes, with their striking red and yellow epaulettes? Did these explorers venture far enough inland to discover the poisonous rattlesnakes of our blue hills? What about the bobcat, black bear, moose, and deer? Some now in limited populations, others rapidly expanding. If the Vikings were here, they certainly marveled at the dozens of beautiful islands along our coast, ranging from small rocks that disappear with the tides, to drumlins of over 200 acres, glacial remnants that play an important role in the propagation of aquatic birds by providing them with nesting sites. They saw snowy egrets. They were rare even in Audubon's day, and were nearly wiped out when their feathers became a popular millinery item. Today, all that has changed. Nesting egrets, black-crowned night herons, and dozens of other shorebirds now enjoy federal and state protection, and are no longer rare. Swans originated in merry old England, where they held the status of royalty. Possession of the bird was a privilege granted only by the king, Edward IV. The snobbery went so far as to allow those select owners of swans to use the swan mark found along the bird's upper bill as a further indication of their ownership. This tradition was carried on in America to a lesser degree when swans were introduced here to grace the palatial estates of the affluent. It's believed the mute swans found along our coast today from southern Maine to Maryland are products of a group that escaped from the estate of Roger Williams, who founded the colony of Rhode Island in 1636. Swan is not really mute, but is capable of making dog-like barks and hissing threateningly, and are extremely aggressive during nesting. In Massachusetts, but here again, their nesting in the state was caused more by the hand of man than nature. At the turn of the century, many Canada geese were kept as live decoys for hunting. This practice became illegal in 1935, but by this time, many birds had already escaped. Others were released in large numbers when sportsmen saw there was no hope of the law being repealed. In the 1960s, the Division of Fisheries and Wildlife initiated a program of relocating geese to inland waterways, where they established resident populations. Our present Boston geese are believed to be products of mixed ancestry. Interior geese from Michigan, Atlantic Canidas from North Carolina, and the giant Canidas from the north. We also have a variety of diving and dabbling ducks. These white-bodied diving ducks are canvasbacks, while the bottoms-up speeders are blacks. Perhaps our most popular game duck. We are, unfortunately, losing many of our black ducks through interbreeding with the tamer mallards, which are becoming more and more hand-fed park ducks. Said that the eastern sportsmen saved the beautiful wood duck from extinction. When the hurricane of 1938 wiped out their natural nesting sites, sportsmen and the Division of Fisheries and Wildlife recognized that the woodies were in trouble and instituted a program of man-made nesting boxes with predator control snouts to prevent raccoons from stealing the eggs and the young. Although these nesting boxes are often used by songbirds and owls, they have nonetheless proved to be the saviors of our wood ducks, and are clearly visible studding our marshes throughout the state. When the ducklings are but a few hours old, they are coaxed into entering the hard, cruel world, and they do it with a splash. And what courage it must take to leave the security of that box for their first venture into space. Miles long, with 60 islands and 118 miles of shoreline. But the real excitement of the Quabbin is the wildlife that visits and lives within its 120,000-acre watershed. Over 20 years to complete the reservoir in 1946. Shortly thereafter, engineers of a different sort started shaping the watershed to fit their own needs. Beavers, which had disappeared from Massachusetts for almost 200 years, reappeared within the lush haven created by the protective confines of the Quabbin Reservoir. Great favorites. smaller snowy egrets also find shelter here. Great blue herons and the smaller green heron can also be found in the flowages. Along with the feisty kingfisher, sandpipers, Wilson snipe, dunlins, and a host of others. Woodchucks can be found throughout the state. Despite the legend of Groundhog Day, they do not emerge from hibernation until well into the month of March. Porcupines were once considered creatures of the deep woods, but have found their way into many of our suburbs. Changes from a golden red in summer to a dull gray in winter. Even the texture becomes different. In the summer, the hair is cellular, while in winter it turns hollow to provide more insulation against the cold. Each winter, unrestrained household dogs kill many deer just for sport. The deer, often does, carrying twins, are slowed down as their hooves break through the snow's crust, while the dogs can race across the top. But without proof, heaven help the person who suggests to a dog owner that they have a killer in their midst. Thank you. tough survivors, like crows, that seem to come through anything. But others, like our regal eagle, can take on the worn look of a survivor. Acceptance at whatever open water holds are available. Dog-killed deer can provide food for some of our struggling animals during the winter. Like this greedy, immature goshawk, who looks like he'd like to fly away with this deer. Or the soaring red-tailed horse, who also comes by for a bite. Diner of them all is the bald eagle, which, with the golden eagle, frequents the Quabbin as a winter haven. According to Benjamin Franklin, the turkey should be our national bird, being more respectable than the eagle. But it's hard to imagine a more beautiful sight than a bald eagle in flight. As even old Ben would probably concede. Canada geese take to the cornfields for whatever pickings are left. Passes into spring.